project was written in your master plan. Like the rest of your institutions and workers around the world through the ages, how you have made special arrangements in your master plan, may it continue to give us peace and assurance, Father, that as we occupy our appointed land, may we remember that you are in control and that you will continue to provide. Father, we also ask for your forgiveness if at times we have experienced unbelief. Please increase our faith, Father, and help us to see and know and understand together that it is your hand that has done it all, and will continue to do so as your workers will be blessed upon that day by you. Today, Lord, we have all come to celebrate your faithfulness and goodness. In our limited expressions and language, Father, please accept our worship this afternoon. All praises and honor belong to you and you alone. In Jesus' name, amen.
We have come together as a people, as a university, as a church, to celebrate God's goodness to us individually and to us as an institution. And indeed, if you're going to look back on what God has done to us, we could exclaim that indeed God is so good. And that God has been giving us His blessings and His provision. The theme of our gathering this afternoon is celebration on God's provision. Celebration on God's provision. As you can see this magnificent building, I'm sure that you will ask, how did this building rise? We would like to say that it is through God's grace. God has provided for His people and for His church and for AUP. And so this afternoon, I would like to welcome you all to this very special program. And we have asked people from AUP and from abroad, our alumni leaders and faculty, to share a message and their testimony, because they have a story to tell. Each one of us has a role in making this dream a reality. But this afternoon we have asked this 13 of them to share a testimony, and we asked them to give a 5-minute testimony and message that I'm sure will inspire each one of us. Because like them, they too have their own challenges, but they have asked the Lord to be God's instruments in helping us making this project or this dream a reality. And so, on behalf of the Adventist University of the Philippines, I welcome you all to our gathering. And may be that the Lord will be praised as we listen to their testimonies and messages, and that we will go home inspired, and that each one will make a commitment to be in the service of God all of our lives as well.
looks like they are also similarly very effective in the presentation of their song.
On behalf of my wife and myself, of course, I am so honored and humbled to be invited to participate in this very historic occasion. Partly this is a historical one because it has eluded for 40 years the plan to open it. And finally this is the realization of it. My testimony today is basically divided into two. One is to show you at least how my wife and I were able to come in into this picture of helping out in the establishment of this institution. And the other one is to appeal to each one of you, from the old, from the new one, and those who are present here, to at least help in many ways in supporting this onward process of having this established, like a role model with this Loma Linda, which has been the flagship of our health institution in the world. You know, I was a president of the alumni organization for 6 years. And over the years, I went through three presidents. Pastor Dr. Saban, and Dr. Gladden Flores, and then Dr. Gayuba. And over the years, I've been involved with this process of having this go forward. During the time of Dr. Saban, we had occasion to meet with him during the convention on a yearly basis. And every time they pass by, we have to pass by Loma Linda and have some conferences with the powers to be in Loma Linda regarding the need for a medical school in this area. And then in 2010, we did have a groundbreaking, not in this place, but it was near the gate. And I was privileged again to be one of the participants during that time. Then Dr. Gladden Flores came. And again, the same process we have to go through. There was an interest to continue with the project, and we have to extol everybody, ask everybody to help out in this significant major project of AUP. However, my first part of my talk, short talk today, is that how I was able to involve myself and my wife. You see, when you have a wife who is very supportive, is very steadfast in her loyalty and commitment, together we walked together for more than 50 years. And I would like to introduce her. She is the love of my life all these years. Mrs. Loida Miguel. There were many occasions where we got so discouraged with this walk that we had, especially in supporting this major project. But being a president of the alumni organization for those 6 years, we move on. And we try to help as much as we can. And for more than almost 40 years of private practice in general surgery and thoracic vascular surgery, the Lord has blessed us has given us opportunity to be a good steward of our Lord. And I would say that she is a very good steward of all the things that were given to us, including our children, our grandchildren, and hopefully the next generation of the girls. And it is a good walk, I would say, because God has blessed us and given us the means to help out in any endeavor, not only in the church, but also in AUP. There is a certain saying, Chinese proverbs, that if you have to see and look back where the source of everything came from, you will not be wrong. You'll be able to know exactly where you came from, and you know exactly how you're going to move on and help out in this process. So there is another thing that I would like to share with you, that the Word of God is a very important resource for us to use in every aspect of our life. And there is one that I would like to share with you. In fact, the Bible is replete with so many things that are necessary for us to follow in our way how to subject or conduct ourselves to things that are eternal. One that really hits me all these many years as a believer in the Lord is found in Matthew 6. If you have your Bible with you, I would like to read it with you. Chapter 6, verse 19 to 21. And then jump into verse 33. It's a word that was spoken by Jesus himself. Starting from verse 19, let me read. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust doth corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there will your heart be also. Okay? Let's go forward into verse 33. This is the advice that was given by the Lord himself. It says here, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. And then finally it says, take therefore no thoughts for the morrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. This has been a guiding principle that has been put in my mind over the years. That no matter how good the Lord has given us enough to sustain our lives, and for some reason he might have given you more than enough, that you have to lay it somewhere. And you have to lay it to accomplish what the Lord has told us. It's basically the essence of the gospel. And that is Jesus himself. It's all about Jesus and all what he had done for us. It's all about his love, the essence of love, which is the true foundation of this law. And then if you have to extrapolate that a little farther, the Lord has given us a new commandment. It's found in Matthew again. It tells us how we relate ourselves in a vertical fashion, and that is love to God. And in a horizontal way, how we have to love our fellow men. Let me make a statement here at this time. Something that I would like to share again. You, all of you here, may not be known to be rich in wealth as far as in anything. You would not be like, we'd say, Bill Gates is one of the richest men in the world, or Warren Buffett. And they are rich and they could donate as much as they could to any cause that you would like to give into. But looking at us, you know, in a very personal way, we don't have that much wealth that we have gathered or accumulated over the years. But there is a need or a cause for us to help out. And it seems that there is a huge need for it to be able to be realized. And in spite of trying to realize it, in spite of doing it in a very traditional way of philanthropy, somebody should take the challenge and eventually realize the dream or the goal that needs to be met. So then each one of us then here, I'd like to challenge you that indeed there's always something that needs to be addressed in the way we have to help out the need of any cause or any endeavor that we are supposed to be involved. And so this afternoon I'd like to appeal to you that there are many aspects in life that you probably could help in many ways. Don't think that because you don't have much, you don't have the talent, you don't have the gift, that you are not able to pursue in helping out other people. And so this afternoon I'd like then to encourage you to try to realize the essence of the gospel, and that is helping out in many ways. In Galatians 6:9, I would say there is another verse that should be shared to you. Galatians 6, verse 9. And let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season we shall reap if we faint not. Let us all then try to do good things for the Lord, for His honor and glory. And we can only accomplish this by the unction of the Holy Spirit. As mentioned in Zechariah, that not by might, not by power, but by the Spirit, saith the Lord. May the Lord's blessing be upon us, each one of us, as we continue the project that has been started. And this is the historic occasion for us to I would say for us to continue forward, especially to the students, to the faculty, and to the supporters of this major project of this institution. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Last March, I asked my son to come with me on the graduation exercise. I gave them two choices. I said, you could come with me March, or you could come with me during the inauguration of the College of Medicine. And his choice coming with me today. And it was a great honor and gratitude to be invited in this historical event of the AUP College of Medicine inauguration. 52 years ago today, and to be exact, on August 28, 1963, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., on the steps of the Lincoln Memorial, with his signature voice said, "Though we face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I will have a dream. I have a dream. I have a dream that one day this nation will rise up and live up to the true meaning of the creed." We hold these truths to be self-sufficient, that all men are created equal. In his speech, marked a defining moment in America's move toward civil rights. The speech, offered to 250,000 people then, reached countless millions since. Even today, it is hailed as a masterpiece of speech. For more than 30 years ago, a visionary and adventurous man of God named Dr. Alfonso Roda had a dream, one last dream, to have an Adventist College of Medicine. Its goal was to restore men into the image of his maker. The medical student must emulate the master physician, Jesus Christ, who ministered and healed to the whole person, body, mind, and spirit. Unfortunately, Dr. Roda did not live long enough to see his last dream to come to reality. However, God's Spirit empowered people with the same passion that Dr. Roda had. God moved mysteriously in many ways. During the AUP Awesna Chapter Rally in Vancouver, BC, I suggested to Dr. Frank Gayoba to finish this building. The AUP College of Medicine, through loans from all sources, and then ask when it's done, why AUP alumni to donate, to support or pay for the loan that has been used. When I came home, I called my son, Edmund Baguindito, to help the funding of the AUP College of Medicine project. I was elated to his response. And also, he said, "Papa, I will help." In more than 30 years since the late Alfonso Roda, first dream of IUP College of Medicine. His dream, his one last dream, it was God who made it possible to become a reality. I am grateful to all who in one way or another who made it possible for Dr. Rada's last dream to come true. I appreciated my wife, my sons, especially Edmund, who have so generously helped me in all our worthy projects, especially the AUP College of Medicine. Finally, the dream was passed on to presidents of this great institution who worked so diligently to achieve it. It's finally realized during the present administration of Dr. Francisco Gayoba. Let me read this verse, Acts 20:35. You know what it is? It is more blessed to give than to receive. When you give, fellow alumni, you will make AUP happy. And when you give to others, a worthy organization, you will make them happy because God has blessed you. Another verse, Luke 1:37. For God, nothing is impossible. To God be the glory. Thank you.
Good afternoon. First of all, I would like to thank the Lord for giving me the opportunity to witness the opening of the medical school here at AUP after many years of hard labor and years of planning. I would like to thank God also for my parents who encouraged me to pursue and finish my education, and also to my maternal grandparents who at their early age went to Hawaii as casadas in my dialect as worker for the pineapple plantation in Hawaii where my mother was born. And after a few years, they went back to the Philippines in Mindanao during the Depression time. My father, as a young man, with his father, walked about 35 kilometers from Danao to Cebu City to pursue his education. And I was always reminded that he told me that if I didn't get my education, I would remain a farmer and you also become a farmer myself. During my high school years at PUC Academy, which was PUC before at Baisa campus, it's now changed to AUP. Whenever we rode a bus in Manila, my father, who used to be the director of the publishing department at the North Philippine Union, whenever we saw a person ride in a nice car with a driver, he always tell me that if you want to be like him, get a good education and finish your education. So after several years, I finished my MD degree, and I thank God that I also met my wife at a medical school. Because my mother was born in Hawaii, I attained my US citizen. So after medical school, I got married, and my wife and I went to the States. It was a struggle to pass the U.S. medical board. It was not easy, but with God's blessings, we both passed the medical board and both of us received our training for my wife, family practice, and I finished my internal medicine at Loma Linda University. God has blessed us and my family, and with His blessings, we are also able to share the blessings here at AUP School of Medicine. And for the upcoming medical students, my advice is always have God be your partner in everything you do, and you will succeed whatever you do. Thank you.
complex. Maganda hapon po sa niyang mata. That's the extent of my Tagalog. Sorry. It's been a long time since I've been in the Philippines. It's been 41 years since I've been here. And I guess it took the inauguration of the medical school to bring me back home. I'm very fortunate in that my wife Julia and my daughter Katie were able to take this long journey with me and able to experience this inauguration with me. I'm very thankful for that. I'm also very thankful and privileged and humbled that we were able to help out in this big endeavor of opening up this medical school. So how did I get involved with this? As my father said, I got involved because of him. He called me up one day, I don't know, about 4 years ago, maybe 3 years ago. And if any of you know my father, he's not shy about asking for money. He pretty much came out and said, "Edmund, I need some money." I said, "Money? Money for what?" He goes, "Well, your Uncle Jun Miguel and I are helping out and trying to build a medical school at AUP. I go, "AUP? What is AUP? He goes, "Well, Adventist University of the Philippines, and they're trying to make, you know, build a medical school." Well, my dad was involved and Dr. Miguel was involved. That was good enough for me. I pretty much asked him, "Who do I write the check out to?" So that's how I got involved with this medical school. I've kind of waffled, gone back and forth on what I was going to say today. In fact, I really didn't decide what I was going to say until about an hour ago. But I'm just going to tell you a little story. I got a call from my dad back in March of this year about the inauguration, and he said that we were invited. I was very excited. In fact, I had started making plans that day. It's hard for me to get time off during the summertime, but I made sure I got time off to coincide with this event. About a month ago, my dad told me, "Oh, by the way, you have to give a 5-minute talk." Five-minute talk, he knows how much I love public speaking. So my wife kept telling me, "Have you done your talk yet? Done your talk yet?" I go, I have the 16-hour flight to make up my talk. So on the plane, I couldn't sleep. I was so excited about this inauguration. We had a layover in Tokyo, and my wife struck up a conversation with this older Filipino lady. She was asking my wife what we were going to do in the Philippines. My wife told her, "Well, we're going to a medical school inauguration." She goes, "A medical school inauguration? There's like a ton of medical schools in the Philippines." My heart just sank. I'm going, "What are we doing building a medical school then, if there's a ton of medical schools here in the Philippines?" So when we got in, my plan was to just, you know, give my 5-minute talk and just kind of stay in the background and try to get out of as many events as possible. I came to the Vespers last night and listened, you know, to the panel of people that were up there that as they gave their devotion on what this medical school means to them. And as I was listening to Dr. Landis' sermon, I actually did listen to the sermon. I kind of got that feeling back again, that feeling of excitement again about this medical school. Yes, there's about 40 medical schools in the Philippines, but this is the only Adventist medical school in the Philippines. And I really do feel like that's really important. I graduated from Loma Linda, and they really taught me a lot about practicing medicine and how to make man whole. And that is really important in our education. So I'm back on the bandwagon. I'm back about being excited about this inauguration and being excited about this medical school opening up. And I believe in the next several years, not only is this going to be the best medical school in the Philippines, but I think this is going to be the best medical school in all of Asia. God bless and good luck.
Good afternoon, everyone. As I looked at the printed program, the corrected program, I just saw my name on the last part of the page. I said, I'm glad I'm going to be the last speaker, so I can speak as long as I could, as I will. But then I saw my name there on the screen to be part of the testimonies, to give the testimonies this afternoon. Well, what do I have to give as a testimony to the establishment of this institution? As a child, I have always dreamed to become a medical doctor. I grew up very sickly. Somehow, when I was 11 years old, I became an errand boy of a medical doctor, the only doctor in our little town back in the home, poor province of Masbate. And I said, when I was helping him as an errand boy, during the next 2 years, I said, one day I'd like to become a doctor. Somehow, the Lord did not allow it. Then, in 1984, that was at the height of the discussions with the late Dr. Alfonso Roda about putting up a medical school right here at the, well, yeah, this campus was just only developed then. And then the Union Executive Committee decided to send me for upgrading for my master's in public health. And I said, this is coming closer to my dream. Soon the next step will be for me to go to school of medicine and I will be a doctor. But that never came true. I was mission president at the age of 38. And when I reached 40, I just decided, just go and forget about becoming a medical doctor. It's too late for you. Just pass it on to one of your children. So when my youngest son graduated from AOP in 2003 from his BS biology, I said, finally, at least one of my children will become a doctor. But instead of coming to School of Medicine after enrolling him in one of the universities in Cebu, he decided to become a nurse. I said, what a preparation for nursing. This biology. So it became another frustration. But how did I get involved with the College of Medicine of AOP? In 2003, during the Spring Council, the General Conference appointed me president of the Southern Asia Pacific Division. And at this time, the president of the college was new, Dr. Saban. And we just organized the Adventist Health Systems Asia at that time, trying to collect together all the hospitals throughout the division. And then there was a strong urge to put up a College of Medicine, at least in the Philippines. And so the committees met at the division, and at that time, what came out was that the College of Medicine in the Philippines should be in Mindanao. Aha, you know what happened. When this was spread all abroad, I received a bombardment of criticism. Yeah, Gulvan, you want the College of Medicine in Mindanao because you're from Mindanao. I'm not from Mindanao. I'm from the Visayas. But this was what was spread. In the internet, I received so many nasty emails. I said, that's fine. And then, because in the committee to be, well, we called Dr. Makaya then, and the others, other presidents of the hospitals that were also beginning their own schools. And we told them, do you really have an intention to put up a college of medicine in your institution? And I said, and then when we voted, I was outnumbered. So what was voted was for Mindanao, Sanitarium and Hospital. So the more criticisms I had, but then the Lord knew my heart. I said, if ever a college of medicine is going to be established in the Southern Asia Pacific Division, it should be at AOP. It is the most prepared institution throughout the division, as far as educational institution is concerned. And so, it went forward. I came home from the annual council in 2012. Dr. Gayoba was already the president. Dr. Miriam Narbarti, Dr. Dores. And that Sabbath weekend, we decided to attend church at AOP. After worship service, I told Dr. Dores and Dr. Miriam, how is the College of Medicine project? And they told me, Elder Gulfan, maybe we just have to put it off. There seems to be no hope at all. The odds are just too much. I think it is not the Lord's plan that we should have a college of medicine. The barriers are just too much for us to overcome. I said to Dr. Dores and Dr. Miriam, the Lord has his own timetable. In due time, if this is the Lord's planning, it will come out. So let's move on. Do not allow these barriers, these discouragements to keep you from pursuing. Let's explore some other possibilities of how we can proceed with this big project. With the support of my fellow officers at the division, we continue to encourage the leadership of AOP. The little that we could do, even though this is not a division institution, we said, Brother Ferrer, my treasurer, said, let us support the project, whatever we can and however we can. And the Lord has blessed. So, finally, approval by Chad was given, and we were so happy. But then there were some more barriers, some more obstacles to overcome. But I said, the Lord has led us thus far. Brethren, let's not get discouraged. But there is no money to finish the building. I said, the Lord is going to provide. And you have heard how the Lord has provided. And so we are very happy that today we have become a part of this inaugural weekend for this College of Medicine project. That is the little part I had in the establishment of this institution. And you know, with Kuya Albert last March, maybe because of the little contribution we had, I had personally the university administration conferred to me a doctoral degree. A dream come true, indeed. Not as a doctor of medicine, but more than that, because they conferred to me, I think, the first one among Adventist ministers that this honorary degree was conferred upon me, Doctor of Divinity. Isn't that great? Never mind, if not a Doctor of Medicine. But now, pwede ko nang maikabit ang title na Doctor sa aking pangalan. But I would say to you, brethren, I would still prefer to be called pastor. So thank you very much. The Lord will continue to bless this institution, Dr. Gayoba. Keep on moving. The Lord has led you thus far. As challenged by Dr. Miguel earlier, let us give what we can And my wife and I decided, we have not given a single centavo to this project. But my wife and I have decided we will give our little contribution, whatever we can, you know, so that we can continue to show our support to the College of Medicine project in this division. And as already been mentioned, let AUP College of Medicine be the best College of Medicine in Asia. The Lord bless each one of you.
My name is not on the program, but I wanted to thank Dr. Gulfan. I got to know him a lot better in March, April of a year ago. And it was a privilege, Dr. Gulfan, to get to know you, to get to understand your passion for what you wanted to see happen, for your consistency of leadership, for your steadfastness despite significant difficulties. And we owe you a debt of gratitude, and to your wife, for your persistence, for your commitment, and your willingness, despite the difficulties of the past and that you encountered recently, of seeing this through to this point. So forgive me the intrusion, but I just felt it important. Many of you were not there when Dr. Alberto became sick. And it's interesting. You get to know, I've had the opportunity to treat many of the saints. And their sanctity comes through when they are under pressure and under fire. He never complained. He never argued. He never pushed back. So we salute you. We appreciate you and Marhelen. And we'll continue to pray for you and remember you as a very significant component of what is happening here today and into the future. God bless you.
School of Medicine run by the Seventh-day Adventist Church organization. River Plate Adventist University in Argentina, Loma Linda University in the United States of America, Peruvian Union University in Peru, University of Monte Morelos in Mexico, Babcock University in Nigeria, and Adventist University of the Philippines envisions to be the sixth by God's grace. At present, AUP has 8 colleges which serve an average of 4,000 students per academic year, of which about 700 foreigners represents 58 countries worldwide, which may...
I have requested that video presentation to be showed first so that my 5 minutes will be reduced. But Dr. Tan has sent me a message, so it will be additional 1 or 2 minutes. Good afternoon, everyone. Today, we are standing on a holy ground. I say holy because God's presence is here. Don't you feel it? All throughout, from our pioneers, from the visionaries of this College of Medicine, we've been praying for the reality and the fulfillment of the vision. It's time to wake up. We are out of the dreamland. We have landed to this building that God has built in His own hands, using human instrumentalities like these donors who are now testifying about God's goodness. Ellen White has something for us. In The Desire of Ages, she wrote, God is not summoned to do what human power can do. What does it mean to us? As a fundraiser, I said to myself, we cannot just be praying and claiming the promise, doing nothing. Because God is waiting for us to do something. Remember at the tomb of Lazarus? Jesus said to the people around the grave of Lazarus, roll the stone. What does it mean? Christ could have just commanded, Lazarus, come forth. But He asked human strength, human power to roll the stone. I praise God that these are the stones, these are the people who roll the stones, that this building has been built because God has used them as an instrument, human instrument. So what are we here for? Now, Ellen White wrote, it is for our own benefit to keep the gift from God fresh in our memory. Why? Thus, faith is strengthened. Strengthened to what? To claim more and more blessing. So, Dr. Borromeo, let us not think about the bills that this building has incurred, because God has already shown us that it is His will that we put up College of Medicine. As a fundraiser, I need to convince myself first, why do I have to get involved? Why do I have to promote this project? So let me share with you three important points why I was motivated, convicted to promote College of Medicine. First and foremost, I am a believer that Christ is coming soon and that the medical missionary work is the right hand of the gospel. Second, I come across with this passage from the writings of Ellen White, Dr. Landless, Pastor Gorfan. Ellen White wrote, and I'm addressing this now to all physicians and physicians to be, our first batch graduates. She wrote, a true converted physician, it's not an ordinary physician, a true converted physician is 10 times more effective in evangelism or soul winning more than any other gospel minister, Pastor Albert. I'm a theology graduate and I took my MPH like you. I spent 8 years at Manila Sanitarium Hospital, Dr. Makaya. I have seen people dying prematurely, unnecessarily, suffering unnecessarily because of physical maladies. So that why Ellen White wrote, a true converted physician is more, 10 times more than effective than any ordinary gospel minister. So I congratulate the first batch of students because you will be 10 times more effective than any of us in the gospel world. Isn't that a big motivation? So I would like to pose the challenge to the director of the Education Department of General Conference. Why only AUP, the 6th College of Medicine, Dr. Lisa? We should have more medical schools, Dr. Charles David, in every country, in every division at least. Because these are what we call, Ellen White wrote, the right arm of the Gospels. The right arm that opens doors. Isn't that we have so many doors to open? Why just now, the 6th medical school? We need to have more medical school throughout the globe because Christ is coming and this is the right hand of the gospel. Three things I have learned in my fundraising. Number one, you share the vision. I do not ask for money. I ask them to catch the vision with us. Because when a person catch the vision, I want to be a part of that vision. So you ask their participation. Would you like to be a part of the fulfillment of the vision? Yes, I would like to. Of course, the money will follow. So money is the least that I worry about during this fundraising time. Why? I got into the Word of God from the Desire of Ages, Dr. Witzel, it says, if the Word is of God, He Himself shall provide for each accomplishment. He doesn't need Beth, He doesn't need any one of us. He Himself shall provide for each accomplishment. So I rest my case in the Lord. Lord, this is your work, so you will provide. But He needs human power. He needs our cooperation. When the work was going on, the groundbreaking until to this CHED's approval, there was a turbulent storm coming, right? You heard all the stories. But you know what? The more it was stormy, I was at peace. I was more comfortable. I am more motivated to share the vision, Dr. Hadley. You know why? I got another word from the pen of inspiration, Pastor Carpina. It says, when God is about to do a work, Satan moves upon someone to object. Oh, I said to myself, I don't like to be part of Satan's agency to object and be a hindrance to this medical school project. So God was just using the thread. God was just using all those critics. God was just using those some financial difficulty because He wants us to know that this is His work. Because of this, Dr. Witzel, Dr. Hadley, Legacy, if some of you haven't read this book, please find a copy at our library. This is my inspiration. Because even the General Conference was seemingly the hindrance to the fulfillment, right, Dr. Landless? Because when John Burden was sharing his burden about Loma Linda, and when they are about to pay the earnest money down payment for the property, he received a telegraphic transfer, a message, don't purchase the property. We don't like the church to be indebted. So this book is my inspiration because Loma Linda, for what it is now today, had it not been for Pastor John Burden, who is in constant communication with God's messenger, Ellen White, said, go and purchase the land. So, in my mind, I was thinking, I was telling the administrators, don't worry, this is God's work, and because this is His work, He will provide for each accomplishment. In Philippians 1:6, He who has begun a good work in you shall accomplish it. He will finish it until the time and Christ Jesus, during at the time of Christ Jesus, meaning until His appearing. And the last quote I'd like to close, the strength of nations and of individuals is not found in opportunities and facilities that appear to make them invincible. It is not found in their boastful greatness, that which alone can make them great and strong. Is the power and purpose of God. Are we accomplishing the purpose of God, not in our own might, by His own power? Genesis 12:2, I will make them great. I will make them great, and thou shalt be a blessing. It is my great honor, opportunity to thank our donors publicly for their constant commitment. Since 2009, ISNAC always in the joint convention in Vancouver, when we promoted for the first time this College of Medicine project. I remember, right, leaving the pulpit, Dr. and Mrs. Baginguito with his wife on a wheelchair, pushing the wheelchair, was running after me, "Beth, how much is one classroom?" I said, "Only $40,000. Please save one room for me that I will sponsor with my family." And if you look at the program now, Dr. Baginguito and family has sponsored 3 classrooms because of the help of children like Edmond and the whole family. Another good story, Dr. Miguel was then the president when we presented the project for the first time in the joint convention. I asked him, "What room do you want to sponsor?" I did not ask him that you give. I asked him, "What room do you want to sponsor?" And he has chosen microparasitology laboratory. But I said, you know, the MedTech group wants it. Being a MedTech, they like that. So when he issued the first check, $65,000, I told him after a month, "Dr. Miguel, I would like to upgrade you to a higher degree, a bigger amount, a bigger room," because he paid it just one payment. The rest was installment, but he gave just one check. So I said, "I know you have more left in your pocket. Let's give more." And he never complained. His wife never complained, Ate Loida. She just said, "I thought we are done with our commitment." I said, "You know, God has blessed you more, because you think you have given? No. God has given this to you because he wants you to give it back to him. Because I say to myself, we don't own anything. What we have, we do not have. Even this breath of life is just a borrowed life. So you are just giving it back to the Lord, because God said, I will make you great so you will be a blessing." And here comes Dr. Elba Luroda and Mr. Kamagai, who has, you will hear their own story. But all of them, and Dr. Wilson Lau, can I just ask, beg 1 minute, his wife, Clem, please come forward quickly. She has something to share, but I want her to share, because I said, "Sayang, your notes is nice. Come here, come. Mom, Clem." You know what, young doctors, young couple doctors, I asked them to give scholarship, and he said right away, "Yes, how much will it cost for one scholar?" But later on, he emailed me, "Beth, I want to give one room instead." So, Mom, Clem, will you please share just one? Because her husband actually spent 3 minutes, so the remainder 2 minutes. Oh, sorry. Yes,
I'm sorry. I'm not really a speaker. I'm a physician. One-on-one encounter is easy for me, but in a group like this, actually, my knees are trembling. But anyway, it's. Actually, what we have given is nothing. What the Lord has given us, we're blessed so much. As a family, me and my husband, actually, we're blessed as a family. We have 2 children, and our oldest daughter is now in Loma Linda School of Medicine and graduating in 2016. And our son, who is in a bachelor's in science in biochemistry and PUC, that's in Alpi Napa in California, and hoping to be accepted to our medical school in Loma Linda, Dr. Hadley. And anyway, actually, I'd like to just say a memory verse that is actually, I take it personally. Actually, I didn't really prepare, but in Jeremiah 29:11, it says, "For I know the plans I have for you, saith the Lord, your plans for good and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope." I claim this as a personal promise for me, but I know it's going to be a promise for all of us, and including the School of Medicine, and also the upcoming, this new batch of medical students. You know, entering PUC in 1974 as a non-Adventist, young, pre-med BS biology, was not my dream to enter PUC. I was not an Adventist then. But then, you know, my father always had a dream that I will be getting an Adventist education. And I believe in a power of prayer, especially power of prayer, praying parents. And his hope at the time was for me to be evangelized through a PUC and eventually being baptized. And as I said, I believe in a power of prayer. I was eventually baptized during my first year of college. And during the time, my father always told me, you know, I wanted you also to have a training as a physician. And, you know, a school of medicine is going to open, PUC is going to open. Well, of course, that didn't happen. I'm almost going to retire now as a physician. And I saw this, a dream come true of my father. But I still believe, you know, that there is really power in parents' prayer. The reason that we were involved in this venue or in this venture is actually last year in 2014, when I got acquainted with Dr. Mendoza, Dr. Daniel Zhang, Dr. Hadley actually had called me last year before the graduation of a School of Medicine to celebrate the centennial. And he asked me, he said, he called me and said, you know, I was inviting, we were inviting all the School of Medicine dean, and I think something happening at PUC, and I don't know why they would not let Dr. Mendoza come. And actually, we didn't know what was happening. So we started calling, and actually we called back at the time. And to make the story short, I said, we'll try to make it happen. And we made it happen. Dr. Mendoza actually came. And we invited her, and with Dr. Miguel, we tried to call some doctors, PUC alumni, to get together in our house. And to let you know, that was providential for me when Dr. Mendoza came. It's been, I seldom come to the Philippines. And when I heard Dr. Mendoza talk about her, actually her experience, and her faith, actually, in, you know, how it came to a point that she became the dean of the School of Medicine, that really touched me, and that brought nostalgic feeling for me for PUC. And that stimulated us, actually, to do something, give back to our alma mater. And, you know, for us as parents, now as a parent, we always wanted the best for our children. And for us, having two children, we always encourage them in the profession of medicine. You know, it's not about money. We're not going to get rich being a physician. But I still believe that being a physician is a humble profession. And this is the way that we can serve. I'm not a speaker, but I'm not a specialist. I'm a primary care physician. But I believe that we have a role as a physician in spreading the third angel's message through health. And that's how I actually have emphasized that to our children. You know, this is the best way that we can serve. And actually, for the upcoming students, you know, I always, you know, the reason why I wanted to give back is because I want them to experience the same thing what I wanted for my children, to be able to attain, you know, their goal to be a physician. And, you know, I just like to say this at the end, you know, that may God continue to pour out His blessings in full measure to the people behind the organization of this College of Medicine, and to the faculty who will be leading the students, not only molding their minds to heal the physical needs of the patients, but most of all, helping these new students develop skills to heal people by directing them to the great physician, and to make each patient, as they meet different patients, helping them to make man whole. Thank you.
Thank you for that more true converted physician. Let me share what just two sentences Dr. Tan has sent through email. Dr. Tan is one of our major donors for the atrium from Crocodile Foundation, Singapore. Most regretful that we are unable to share the joy with you today. We have been abundantly blessed by the Almighty God. We are happy that we can participate in His works on earth. We congratulate AUP on this gracious opening of your College of Medicine, and we wish you every success. From Dr. Tan Yan Chin. May the Lord bless us. Mabuhay ang AUP College of Medicine. Long live Adventist University of the Philippines. God bless us.
you. Good afternoon. The difference between these guys and me is that these guys are Americans, and I'm a Filipino. And every morning they wake up, they go outside to their backyard, and they go to their mango trees, and they go to their calamansi trees, and they pluck $1,000 notes. See, that's how they make their money. I work at the Kaiser Hospital ER in Riverside, and for night nurses, they run my life. At the end of the day, they collect an offering and give it to me. So that's the difference between these guys and me. That's not true. And Dr. Miguel, isn't a beer company named after you? Anyways, it's so nice to be back in here. Today, for a few minutes, I want to share with you my life story, very short. And hopefully no one thinks this guy is Mayabang, but I just have to share. Maybe someone might take some encouragement. These kids are my kids. Thank you. I've always wanted to, let's put it this way. Every people group all over the world offer its own avenue to the preaching of the gospel. What is very good for one place is totally worthless somewhere else. So I came to this country, I came as a pauper, I married a beautiful girl, and I got an MD degree. So this is Otang Na Loob, you know. So I says, Lord, how can I really make an impact in the society in this country? I donated a piano here a long time ago, handbills. So the money I put in for this place, all that put together, these bills are much more expensive than that. And we got to buying a San Miguel company, beer company, bus, it's air conditioned, so they go places. And our ministry is based on John chapter 4, verse 13 and 14. Lord talks about fountain of living water. And so when they go and play, they're given enough money for the bus and for the bus driver, for gasoline and the toll. And I've already talked with my friend Jan. Where are you, Jan Carvajal? Right there. Yes, and you know, she and I have been friends for more than 40 years now. Before I came, I went to San Bernardino, to the place where her dad is. And I needed to see him before I came. And her mom was telling the nurse, he's my oldest son, Philippine Union College. Even now, Dr. Roda's wife, Mrs. Roda, calls me her son. I was in Bacolod Sanitarium, Dr. Hislani. I just went and visited with his widow. I was a son to him as well. Dr. Loreto Garcia, Dr. Cebu Sanitarium Hospital, what was his name? Tornelius. You know, all these folk love me to death. And how can I give back any little, anything less? But you see, these kids have already played for ambassadors in this country. They played for the ambassador of Vatican in this country. Our job is not to count our converts. Our job is to go and teach. And Jan is going to be working with them. And hopefully the medical students, you're going to join them. And what a powerful force to go from Sabbath to Sabbath, from church to church, and speak to them the word of God in the best way possible, with beautiful music and jaw-dropping messages from the Lord. You know, if we say we have the message of the hour, we've got to know what that message is. We've got to know the method, and we already know we have the means to take his word. You felt that there are 40 medical students, there are 45 medical students in medical schools in this country. I went to Firestone University, 300 students in the first class. I think about 50 of them flunked out or whatever, you know, but we were about 250 who graduated from the school. So there's much more than 5,000. And you kids, you're just a trickle in the bucket. And in a little while, I'll share why I really got involved into the School of Medicine here. Because we've got a message that's second to none. We have already been given the message. We've got to know what it is and go forward. I was talking with you about my coming. I came to the Philippines the same time. I was classmates with Mrs. Lau. You see, Jan, Ruby, Ruby's dad is here. Ruby Kamagai, she's going to be one of your faculty members. So 1974, the plane brought me to this country, and I got to the custom. And the custom gentleman says, oh, you're going to PUC. My daughter goes there. Sign the paper, let me go. I said, wow, this is great. Go to the taxi driver, and you know, got in the taxi, I'm going, and he's fussing. He says, you know, they just raised the price of gasoline. Imagine. You know, we love that word, right? We love that word. Imagine, imagine it's 1 peso 25 cents per liter. Ha. You think I'm ancient, huh? Anyways, so go to PUC. All PUC. I love that campus. I was a pauper, I had no money, I hardly ever got out of the place. Very old buildings, but beautiful people. Beautiful, beautiful people. 3 years we used to go to places. We used to go to Sambales among the Aetas. And there was a gentleman who had severe osteomyelitis, you know, pus dropping every day like condensed milk. And I would wash this with my bare hand, and the girls wouldn't let me touch the food anymore. I was not clean. So coming back, I went to PGH, and they took me to send me to the senior vice president of PGH. So I'm sitting there and talking with him, a foreigner, and I'm pleading the case for this Aeta. And he leans forward and he says, you're a foreigner, why are you here? Why not the Filipinos? Well, long story short, we got him there to PGH in Mr. Kamagai's car. And he had an amputation, got the pair of crutches. The Lord blessed us in our efforts, and a church was built there. We used to hold 5-day plans, and many faculty members' kids were in this group that had no name. We had no leaders, and we did wonders. I'd leave the campus Friday afternoon, knowing I had no money when I'd come back, but the Lord never, ever, ever failed me. Beautiful, wonderful experience in Philippine Union College. I still love to call it Philippine Union College. Sorry, Dr. Gayoba, you know, some people don't learn. But it was time to apply for med school. And you know, foreigners have no choice. Wherever you are accepted, you go there. West Visayan State College, 280 of us took the exam, 3 of us passed. One was a Jewish guy, another was an African, and me. They were going to take two of us. I was accepted after the interview, and the Jewish gentleman, from Africa, was hurt, and I had a problem. The Filipinos, 1,000 pesos per semester. Me, $1,000. I had no $1,000. I was told at the time that the dean of the school was a Dr. Mendoza. I never met her. She was in the States. So I came back to the Philippines. I got a call from Philippine Union, from the president's office. There were only 3 phones at that time. What a blessing. Entire campus, 3 phones. So I go to his office. They told me, go to FEU right now, Thursday afternoon. Go to FEU, you go there. He says, you have Thursday and Friday to register to get into the medical school. Well, I flew down to Iloilo because I had no money. I know FEU I could handle, but Iloilo, there's no way. So, plus a woman was waiting for me, young lady, I had to marry her. So no one else would marry her, probably. So, I'm just kidding. So I go there and get the paperwork, come back. One of the things that was required was no objection certificate. Well, I did not have the visa ran out, and the gentleman who was the liaison officer really didn't do his work. And I'm saying, Lord, I pulled out of West Visayas State College, and now I cannot get into a field that accepted me. Where do I go? Help me. So I go to the Department of Education, and I pray, Lord, when you were in this world, you made people, gave them sight. I just pray you make them blind for this one day. So I go in there, thousands of kids from all over the world waiting for that paperwork. And all these secretaries are working very hard, feverishly, to get this work done before the sun goes down, before 5 o'clock. So a gentleman from inside comes up, picks up a stack of paper documents, sits down, first name to be called, Charles David. I go there, I say, Lord, please make him blind. He looks at me, he looks at the, oh, you're going to FEU, School of Medicine, great school. My daughter is a student there, you're going to love it. He signed his name and let me go. No visa. I believe that the Lord had its way in my life. Well, then I went to the States and I got the residency, and then I've been working last 10 years in California. One main reason why is half of Californians are Filipinos. So my wife has a lot of friends. You know, half of General Conference was Filipinos. You know that? But anyways, they're found in heaven, not in hell. Purgatory, yes, many of them. But, you know, so it's great. My wife loves it, and I travel all over the world. I'm going to have to share this with you. 5 years ago, I'm going to Pakistan to do a week of prayer at our college. So the Pakistani pastor takes me to the consul's office. I'm sitting outside. I worked last night. I'm wearing rags. You know, I'm tired. I want to sleep. He went and had a big mouth. He says, he's a doctor. So they got me in there. The gentleman, he stands up. He says, Pakistan is a dangerous country. Why do you want to go there? I told him I'm going to give some health lectures. I was not going to tell him the whole truth. And he says, hey, I have high cholesterol. Can you help me? And he's on statin drugs. So I give him my talk. He says, come on over. Took me to the Secretary General's office, or the big boss's office. And he stood up, shook my hand. He says, we're going to give you multiple entry visa into Pakistan. You come back, speak to us about health. You see, we've got to earn our rights to be heard. We've got to earn our rights to be heard. So I go to Pakistan. Here is an assemblyman, like a senator in this country. He comes with a truck full of automatic weapon holding gun, you know, soldiers to talk with me, to get help from me. Severe coronary artery disease, 36 years old. Sit there, talk. And he says, I want to eat the food you've been talking about. I talked with him about a lady who lived 150 years ago who didn't have a third grade education. And his jaws hung loose. He said, I want to know more. I'm going to come back tomorrow, 5 o'clock. He comes 5 o'clock with his brother. Same story, severe coronary artery disease. And we talk, he says, I want to eat your food. So we prepared food for him there. I'm going to go back again next year from Islamabad to Karachi to Rotary clubs. That's why I'm a Rotarian. You know, over here or in the States, of course, people wear shorts and whatever, jeans to go to Rotary club. In those countries, chauffeur-driven cars, big guys. Lord loves those guys as much as he loves you and me. We've got to work with them. I was going to go to India, so I put the application form. They said, why did you go to Pakistan? First question. You have to beat me to pulp to find out I'm a doctor. I do not talk with people saying I'm a physician. So I wrote there, big bold letters, I am a Seventh-day Adventist physician. I go all over the world wherever I'm needed. In 2 weeks, they give me multiple entry 10-year visa. You see, folk who are going to med school, if you're going to compete with the world, you cannot do that. I was talking with the PhilInvest. You know PhilInvest, you know that place? Second largest investment company, corporation in this country. Next to them is the is the big Asia hospital. The whole afternoon, I was supposed to meet with them for half an hour. The whole afternoon, we talked about Adventist understanding of health. And this lady turns around and she says, "You mean to say you are going to put them out of business?" It all depends on what you want to learn. I work in the ER and I see side effects of beta blockers and coumadins and ACE inhibitors. People with swollen throat, they can, we have to intubate them. You know, these are the medications are really not the answer. You will know the answer because you've been given the answer 150 years ago. I would, you know, I have lots of friends who are big bosses in ISNAC and the and alumni. And one of them asked me one time, "Charles, every time we talk about medical school in the Philippines, why don't you say a word? Because if I'm not interested in something, I'm not going to criticize it here." Very simple. I says, if it were again today and I was a pre-med student, I'd still go to FEU because my professors, my dean, everyone knew that we were Seventh-day Adventists and we will not budge no matter what. Even to this day, even the owner of the big hospital in Paseo, my friend, I meet them, you see. Why? I'm Mr. Nobody, absolute pauper. But the Lord has given us a message second to none, and I encourage you young people to know why you want to go to med school beyond writing prescriptions. I have 15 minutes less with patients. We see 36,000 patients in one physician, two PAs. And very short time. And I'll tell them, I says, people, we already know that this patient is a smoker. I tell them, you have to be an absolute idiot not to know that smoking is bad for you. But let me tell you how you can quit in a couple of minutes. I'll have so many patients come back and shake my hand and says, "Thank you for talking with me, I quit smoking." Young people, so many, these hands have delivered so many babies from newborns, from mothers 13-year-old giving birth. You see, we have a challenge that's bigger than us. If you want to make money, yeah, you're gonna big name, you can make a lot of money. But question is what do you do with that big name and what you do with the money. I know many of you consultants here, teachers here are not Seventh-day Adventists. I just pray that you will see the love of Christ fully manifested in the hearts of the teachers and students in here, or else we have failed you. Same with you teach students. I think that you know that you have walked with God's children. Dr. Mendoza, the same way when you were studying Adventism, that now you're not disappointed, that you know, even going through this hardship and pain of being the founding dean, that you look back and says, "I walked with God's children. I walked with God's children." Let me, you know, I was a slow learner, so it takes me a longer time, so I'm not sure what time it is, I don't know what. But let me tell you a few things. 2013, Manila Bulletin, I used to read this magazine a long time ago, newspaper. 2013, the DOST, Department of Science and Technology, right? In 2000, 16%, 20% of men and women in this country were obese. In 2008, it jumped up to 27%. In 1963, only 4.3% of Filipino children were obese. In 2007, 19.4% of Filipinos are obese. Bicol Standard in 2008 said one out of every five adult Filipinos is a diabetic. In 2007, Philippine cardiovascular outcome study shows 20.6% of adult Filipinos are diabetic. What is in 1999, less than 10 years ago, only 3.9% of Filipinos were diabetic. Folk, this national crisis, disaster, is a golden opportunity for us, Seventh-day Adventists, medical students, to make a difference. You should be able to be, you should be invited in FAU, Far Eastern University School of Medicine, to present the findings that veganism, vegetarianism makes a difference, that the Lord knew what he was saying when he told us what to eat before the fall, Genesis 1:29. You cannot compete with the schools in this country to be the first or the board top notcher. If you do that, I really want to pull back. But you can be known all over the country, all over the country, as people who really, truly have the secret of healthy living, right here. Maybe your studies could start in a PUC cafeteria. Sorry, Dr. Gayova, I don't eat in the cafeteria because you have too much salt and my blood pressure will go up. We need only 2 grams of salt a day. Only 2 grams of salt a day. And this hypertension would probably gone from this country if indeed we stopped going to KFCs and McDonald's. You know, when I was here, there was nothing called KFC and there was no McDonald's. Filipinos were healthy. What has happened? You are the answer. By the way, Joy, it's so nice to see you. I went on a medical mission in Panabo last year. They were having a crusade and they asked me to come and give the lifestyle presentation. And Joy was one of them who was baptized at that time. So nice seeing you to be the first year medical student in here. Monday morning, I fly to Bangladesh and money has already been sent there. And I signed a paperwork to purchase land to start a physician assistant program and teacher training program, $200,000. By the time it's all done, it's going to be a couple of million dollars, and there goes my retirement. You see, when Noah was done building his ark, he was totally broke. The only thing he needed to do is to go to safety. That is our challenge. You know, when my life is done, I want to be totally broke. But the work needs to be done. We're not to count our converts, we're to go and teach. It's a golden opportunity to work among the Muslims. I have very rich Muslim friends, very rich. You know, Bangladesh is no longer the basket case that Henry Kissinger talked about. This jacket, Joe Bank, made in Bangladesh. This shirt, made in Bangladesh. My shoes. You know, these are top brand clothes, all made in Bangladesh, okay? The Lord loves these people. The man, the richest man of clothing, wants to meet with me, a Mr. Pauper, because he's having medical problems. We have a challenge greater than us. For you medical students, right here in your own campus. You see, by the time the sun goes down, 12 Filipinas will die of complications of cervical cancer. All the cancer deaths, 16% of all cancer deaths in this country is caused by breast cancer. We are bigger than ourselves. Let us work hard to make men whole the way the Lord wanted us to be. God bless.
Magandang buhay po sa inyong lahat.